Ladies and gentlemen, there are two questions.
Yes, the first one is a question. Is it so that compassion can only be described in terms like it is not this, it is not that, but it is the universal background of everything? So can it be equaled with life itself?
Well, I think it's better to not describe it in negative terms. So it's better, it's one of our exercises we give in our course Thinking Differently, that you should make an image of how the world looks like, positively, yeah, an ideal world, an universal brotherhood. So what's happening? You work together, there is cooperation, you live for each other. And compassion is always, I think, a realization of the unity of the hierarchy where you are a part of. And because there is boundlessness, you know, the perception of unity always grows when you grow in your consciousness, and that means that your compassion always can grow as well. So better not to describe it in negative terms. Maybe I did it in my lecture. Well, the next time I will improve it. Sorry if I did it. No, you should better tell what it is. And I think that if you see life written with a capital L, so the universal life, then you know that the oneness of everything is a fact in nature. Yeah. So universal brotherhood is a fact in nature. So in that sense, if you life is, I think, the same as compassion. That's why Blavatsky says, HPB says in The Voice of the Silent, it's the law of laws. It's the keynote of the universe, because everything really exists because of everything else. There is not such a thing as separateness. And if you realize that, then you are a compassionate being, whatever the scope of your consciousness may be.
Okay, and the second question we got is, how can I wake up the Buddha in myself? Because I'm so often far away from my inner core.
Well, the fact that the one who asked these questions shows that he is not so far away from his inner core. If he was really far away from his inner core, he didn't have asked it. But it's in fact the exercises I tried to give at the end of the second part of my lecture. Try to imagine a Buddha. Try to imagine a universal brotherhood. The exercise of William Quine Church, you will find it in letters that had helped me. I think it's a very, very practical and very inspiring exercise. Go in your mind to everything you know. Think about it and try to realize that you are your friends and your enemies and the inhabitants of the country where you live and the animals and the plants and the stars. Try to imagine it. If you do that every day, just 10 minutes, you will find out that it will become easier if you repeat it. And then at a certain moment, you have developed yourself in such a way that it is normal for you to think not from out of your personality, but from out the big whole. Then you realize that there is such a thing as cooperation and connectedness. But you have to try it, you have to do it, and sometimes it doesn't work. That doesn't matter, because there's another day, you can try it again and again and again, and it will become very easier. And at the end, it gives so much happiness, and so your life will become very easier in a way, because, of course, the challenges of life will always be there, but you have that knowledge, that certitude that you are one with everything that is, and that gives peace of mind. Yeah?
Yeah. In the meantime, a third question comes in, but that is about the avatar, so I think we will just wait with that question till you have had the third part.
All right. Now let's start with the tulku. Tulku, which by the spread of Tibetan Buddhism in the West has also gained some familiarity here, although it is seldom understood as Theosophy does, and the concept is also highly subject of degeneration. What is Tulku? Well, in the Tibetan popular tradition, there is usually a high lama or another high cleric, the head of a monastery, for example, who, after his death, fairly quickly reincarnates into a child who will succeed him. In ancient Tibet, nowadays this tradition has been eradicated by the Chinese occupation, or is subject to Chinese manipulation, but in Tibet before the Chinese occupation, such a high lama gave instructions during his last life on earth to those who are left behind. He told them, for instance, in which region he will reincarnate and how they can recognize his new birth. After his death, such a lama, then there are high monks who carefully will search for a young child who gives signs of recognition of the deceased lama. He chooses, for instance, from different things, such as prayer wheels, exactly the one which belonged to the deceased lama. If he succeeds, it means that he is a tulku, according to the Tibetan popular tradition. Then it is assumed that the high lama has returned into the world. However, according to Theosophy, the case is much more complicated. According to us, a tulku is a cooperation of two beings in which one transmits a part of his consciousness to another. That may sound strange, but it happens regularly in our world. The most famous case is that of a hypnotist. A hypnotist switches off, as it were, a part of the hypnotized person consciousness and plants a part of his consciousness into that of the other one. As a result, the hypnotized person can do certain things that he would otherwise never had done. In this way, for instance, some people try to get rid of an addiction, such as smoking. Even in advertising, something like this happens. The essential difference with tulku, however, as it takes place in the hierarchy of wisdom and compassion, is that in the case of hypnosis, free will is eliminated, whereas tulku always take place on the basis of free will. Both parties, both beings, are aware of what happens, and they give their permission. Now, tulku can only take place if the receiving party, if I might call it like this, has a characteristic that is in line with the giving party. Or a human being who wants to serve as a vehicle for a tulku must live in the spirit side of his consciousness. Let's try to explain this by using the diagram that we showed before. Human consciousness consists of spirit, soul, and body. The soul has an impersonal side and a personal side. This is almost the same slide, but we have replaced manas, higher manas, and lower manas instead of personal and impersonal. Manas means thinking or mind, the ability to think. The higher manas is selfless, is humble, lives in a sense of connectedness. It has all the virtues, it tends towards the spirit. The lower manas is the person of the personality that lives in a sense of separation and this tends towards self. Selfishness. Well, if a person lives permanently in his higher manas, when he is compassionate, He becomes a disciple, a pupil, we call it a chela, of one of the masters of wisdom and compassion. Such a chela has learned how to control his lower manas, how to control the personality. He is fully disciplined. He is in control of himself. Controlling doesn't mean suppressing. It means that you live according to your highest vision of selflessness and unity. You no longer react to every external impulse, or you don't have any transient personal desire. You are a master of this. Many people are often the slave of their lower manas. They cannot neglect or control their personal emotions of desires. They see all kinds of things and are distracted by them. They are unable to focus on their higher self, or at best, they only focus temporarily on it. However, in the case of Tulku, the personality must be disciplined completely. If a chela is the master of his lower manas, it is possible that a high being exert a certain influence on the lower manas of the other in such a way that the other becomes a kind of extension of that more evolved being. So there is a spiritually trained human being like a chela, a disciple on the path of compassion who has only the welfare of mankind in mind, and then a master of wisdom and compassion, or a Buddha, or even divine being, has the opportunity to work with such a chela. And this cooperation takes place, and that's very important, without affecting the characteristic or free will of the chela. It's a voluntary cooperation. It takes place when there is an important spiritual work to be done in the world. A good example of a tulku was H.P. Blavatsky. H.P. was the principal founder of the Theosophical Society. She had come into contact with her master at an early age, so she had already undergone intensive training in previous lives so that she could be a vehicle of the hierarchy of wisdom and compassion. Her master asked her if she was willing to take on a task that would bring her great suffering. As you can see, the hierarchy of compassion only works with volunteers. It was a very important task she had to undertake. She had to make the ancient wisdom known again, especially in the Western world. Years of training followed. She traveled to many places in the world, underwent all kinds of training. She spent 3 years in Tibet, where a special psychological event took place. More about that later. Blavatsky's training was to become a pure receiver of the influence and forces that were transformed into her from that hierarchy of wisdom and compassion. And to do this work, it is necessary that a part of the psychological nature of Blavatsky was put out of action. That part was turned off, and in its place came a part of a very high master of wisdom and compassion. In fact, HPB was disabled in her psychological nature. She had her moods. She was a mystery. Almost nobody understood her. And that's logical, because a part of her was absent. By means of a tremendous mind power, she could function as a tulku in order to perform the great work that had to be done in the world. That work was indeed very great and very important in a world rotten by materialism and dogmatic Christianity, some light of the truth had to shine again. This requires enormous spiritual strength, spiritual power. In some moments of her life, Blavatsky was nothing more than the vehicle of that power. Those were the moments when she spoke with the authority of a great master. At such moments, there was no H.P. Blavatsky, there was H.P.B., because there is a difference between H.P. Blavatsky and H.P.B. H.P. Blavatsky is that high chela, that self-sacrificing human being who was willing to take on great suffering in order to alleviate the suffering of mankind. But H.P.B., as H.P.B., she was the mouthpiece, the extension, so to speak, in the outer world of the universal hierarchy of wisdom and compassion. In her own copy of The Voice of the Silence, Madame Blavatsky wrote this dedication, H.P.B., to H.P. Blavatsky, with no kind regards. There's another situation in which tohu can take place. From the spiritual, divine realm, an influence pervades into the soul of a human. That influence is absorbed by manas and takes shape in the outer world through the body. The divine works together with the human. This is the case with the Dalai Lama and the Tashi Lama. Both are tulku. The Dalai Lama is the official external spiritual head. He does all the public and social affairs. He leads the rules and rules. He leads and rules the Tibetan people. He preserves the knowledge of Tibetan Buddhism. The Tashi Lama, also known as the Panchen Lama, is less well known in our Western world. He's the teacher and guardian of esoteric Tibetan Buddhism. The Tashi Lama protects and is responsible for keeping pure the mystical secrets of Tibetan Buddhism. He is the spiritual force in the background, less visible in this world, but in a certain way even more holy and important than the Dalai Lama. He trains and teaches his disciples the secret of pure Buddhism. At least this was the situation in ancient Tibet. After the occupation by China, there is not much left of this system. This mystery school has ceased to exist, I'm afraid. At least it stopped to exist in the outer world. In the inner world, it never can stop to exist. The Chinese kidnapped the Tashi Lama when he was a little child. Nobody knows where he is. Amnesty International called him the youngest political prisoner. Apparently, the Chinese have appointed their own Tashi Lama who had to dance to their tune. They don't understand much about Buddhism in Tibet. They abuse the system for their short-sighted, selfish political ends. The Tashi Lama and the Dalai Lama are tulku in the sense that they are a ray of two cosmic beings, two cosmic compassionate forces called Avalokiteshvara and Amitabha Buddha. Amitabha Buddha is a cosmic divine force, a force that is within us as well, within everybody, but our consciousness is still so far removed from that compassionate power that we don't experience it as an active force in our lives. This power radiates into the Tashi Lama. Avalokiteshvara beams over the Dalai Lama. His name means the Lord who is perceived or known. His influence can be observed or known in our higher self. The Tashi and the Dalai Lama are both spiritual trained so that they can express this divine force, this cosmic power in our world. From these two divine beings, an exalted influence is emitted, which is absorbed by the soul of the Dalai Lama and the soul, in the case of Amitabha Buddha, by the Tashi Lama, and thus takes shape in this outer world. Do not think that this doctrine is exclusively a Buddhist doctrine. It is not. When Jesus speaks about his Father in heaven, and that he and the Father are one, he is referring to the same principle, that a cosmic power takes shape in a human being. In this context, it is interesting to quote an interview with the Dalai Lama. The Dalai Lama was asked whether Avalokiteshvara will withdraw from this world because the current Dalai Lama might be the last one. He laughed heartedly. The Dalai Lama always laughs heartedly. And then he said that there were incarnations of Avalokiteshvara long before the Institute of the Dalai Lama, and that there certainly will be incarnations of Avalokiteshvara after the Institute of the Dalai Lama. When it has ceased to exist, there will surely be other incarnations of this cosmic power. Compassion will always be in the world as long as there are people who are accessible to it. Even you or me, we can be tūku too. Probably for a short moment, because we have not yet learned to discipline ourselves in such a way that we can shape that divine power for a long time. But if we identify ourselves with our higher manas, even for a short period of time, then we may be the vehicle of a higher force. Avatars. The meaning of avatar in the ancient wisdom is the descent of an energy of a celestial being in order to overshadow and illuminate a human being. And you see, tūku is in some cases the same as avatar, but there is much more to say about it. First of all, you would like to note that there are two different types of avatars: anupapadaka avatars and upapadaka avatars. Firstly, let's say something about the anupapadaka avatar. What does it mean? One who does not come or go according to a line of succession. In other words, he is parentless. And that means that this avatar has achieved this status thanks to himself. He has, metaphorically speaking, no parents who have helped him to get the status of avatar. He is, so to speak, born out of himself. He is self-born, born from the divine essence that he, in his inner core, is. So the anupapadaka avatars are those avatars who have reached this status by self-motivation, by self-activity. They worked very hard for it. They started like us, to imagine what it is to be a Buddha. Yeah? They all started in the same way, so we can be it one day as well. These avatars are those beings who, for a longer or shorter period of time, because of their inner strength and power, make their souls a suitable channel through which their own inner spiritual part can flow into the outside world. They are the vehicle of their own inner divinity. This divine spiritual influence can work directly in the world of mankind. At such a moment, there is a descent of a divine influence. Spirit, soul, and body are aligned to which the stream from the divine heart of the cosmos can flow directly and purely into our world. Examples of this kind of avatar are Buddha, the Buddha Gautama, and Krishna. Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, whenever a decline of duty comes into being, a spring of and spring up of unrighteousness, then I emanate myself for the preservation of the righteous, for the destruction of the evildoers, for the sake of establishing duty. I take birth from age to age. Buddhas, when a human being is permanently united with his divine part, not temporarily, but permanently, he is a Buddha. So, a Buddha is also a kind of avatar, but someone who is united with his own inner divinity. So he is permanently aware of the illusions of the outer world. He lives forever in the awareness of unity, interconnectedness. He sees that the outer world is nothing more than an illusion. A Buddha has detached himself from the illusions of the outer life, and therefore he deserves nirvana. In other words, he can live permanently in the spiritual, divine realm. But does he do that? If it is a Buddha of compassion, he doesn't. Then he refuses nirvana and remains in the sphere of the earth in order to be able to continue encouraging people, inspiring them to go the path of liberation, to walk the path of compassion. There's a wonderful story in the Mahabharata, the ancient Indian epic. One of the heroes of the story, one of the Pandavas, comes accompanied by his dog after much wandering and much suffering at the gate of heaven. And the gate of heaven opens and he is received like a hero. However, he is told that his dog is not allowed to enter. "Then I don't want to enter heaven as well," he says. This story indicates exactly what the status of a Buddha of compassion is. Because of beings that which are less developed, you give up what you are entitled to. You give up what you deserve. You sacrifice your own bliss for others. Besides the Anupapadaka avatars, there's another type of avatar, and these avatars are even more complicated, more complex, and more rare. They are the one-time or the constructed avatars. They are called Upapadaka avatar. There are three beings. There is a voluntary cooperation of three beings. Every being has a spirit, has a soul and a body, but in the case of the Upapadaka avatar, the three parts of consciousness are delivered by three different beings. So there is a spirit, there is a soul, and there is a body, but all three parts come from another entity. There is a voluntary, one-time cooperation of three entities. On this diagram, you can see that the spirit, the spiritual part, is divided by a god, a divine being, and the soul part is divided by a Buddha of compassion, and the body is divided by a human being. Each of these beings has its own level of awakening, its own range of consciousness. The divinity lives in the divine world of nirvana. The Buddha lives in that intermediate sphere, the inner sphere of the earth. And the pure human lives on earth. And these three enter into a partnership. They do so to transform wisdom and compassion from the spiritual realms to our human realms. You could compare this construction with an architect, the god, the divine being, a contractor, the intermediary, and a builder. They work together for a particular project. And when the job is done, they continue their own evolution. So as a composite whole, this avatar is an illusion. It has no past and it has no future. The divinity does have a past and a future, and the Buddha has a past and a future, and the human being that delivers the vehicle has a past and a Buddha, but as composed being, they don't. So they are an illusion in that sense. In Gnostic Christianity, there is a curious doctrine which contemporary scholars call docetism. The doctrine affirms that Jesus had an illusory body when living on earth. In the Nag Hammadi scriptures, there are funny texts in which Jesus is crucified, but the living Jesus, so he is called, is standing laughing under the cross. And although this doctrine is too far-reaching and exaggerated, its core is right, namely that an avatar is an illusory phenomenon with no past and with no future. Jesus and Sankaracharya, the Indian teacher and the informer of the Vedanta philosophy, were such upadaka avatars. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we have shown you three possibilities, three ways in which the hierarchy of compassion tries to make contact with our outer world. You understand that there is much and much more to be said about these mystic subjects. There are many wonderful details to be given if you read the esoteric teachings number 10 of Dr. Gottfried de Perucca. You will find some marvelous teaching about the hierarchy of wisdom and compassion. We have just 1 hour to tell you something about it, but there's many more to say. There's one thing I would like to say. I think I've said it all twice or maybe 3 times already, but it's very important. There can never be any influence of the hierarchy of compassion if there's nothing corresponding to the main characteristic of the hierarchy among those who have to undergo that influence. But the other thing is also true. If there is a corresponding characteristic, so when you evolve compassion, when you are compassionate, then there is that influence of the hierarchy of compassion, even if you don't know it. The main characteristic of the hierarchy of compassion is, of course, compassion. It's not so much the idea that you have to do good, but that you are good, that you are selfless, that you have some sense of unity, and that you therefore never seek your own benefits, never seek your own bliss. How wise you are, how much insight you have into all those sometimes complicated teachings of avatars and tulku is actually a secondary matter. And that's why I like to end this talk with 2 questions for you. You don't have to answer them. Think about it. And if you can say no to both questions from the bottom of your heart, and if you are willing to draw the consequences of those answers, then sooner or later, you will join this oldest community of humanity, this universal hierarchy of wisdom and compassion. Or perhaps you already have that connection, but you don't know it. So, what are these 2 questions? You will find them in that marvelous book of HPB, not H.P. Blavatsky, but HPB, The Voice of the Silence. Can there be bliss when all that lives must suffer? Shall thou be saved and hear the whole world cry? Thank you. Are there any questions?
Yes, we have a few questions. Let's start first, quite a technical question. How can I imagine that a part, for example, of Madame Blavatsky was deactivated? What does it look like? When she was like a tulku functioning.
You will find in one of the letters of the masters of wisdom and compassion, the teachers of H.P. Blavatsky, a letter to A.P. Sinnott, wherein Kuthumi tries to explain AP Synod what is happening. Because if you want to influence somebody, if you want to be an extension of those masters, something in your consciousness has to be put off, because you cannot mix your own ideas with those of the hierarchy of compassion. There is another reason, and that is even more complicated to understand, and that is when the dukkha doesn't work anymore, or the dukkha is going on a way which is not a compassionate way, then the masters have the possibility to end it. So something in the manas, in the psychological nature of the one who receives that force of the hierarchy of wisdom, has to be put off in order to receive purely that immense force of the hierarchy of wisdom. And in the case of Blavatsky, it was not just a master, it was a very high master. And in fact, it was the high master, we call it the silent watcher, who has a connection with the divinity, the silent watcher of the whole planet. So it was a very, very spiritual, divine force that was working through Blavatsky. And the work she did was very, very important. Even theosophists don't recognize the importance of the work of Blavatsky. It was a work for centuries. So that's why that special surgery took place in Tibet.
Another question is, can I see an analogy with an avatara and the practice of life? Can I be an avatar to others on my human-like way?
Well, the very important is that we are volunteers. So it's very dangerous to put your energy, your thoughts, on that of another. Don't do that. That's not the way the hierarchy of wisdom and compassion works. So it's better not to experience with that. But you can be an avatar, an anupapadaka avatar, a tuku, when you are the vehicle of your own divinity, your own higher self. And the only thing you have to do is be impersonal, The only thing you have to do is be compassionate, realize that you and the others are one, and if that happens, you open your channel in yourself for the influence of your higher consciousness, of the higher self, and then you are also a kind of tulku. That's why I said, even you and me, we can be tulku, just for a short while, probably, because we are not so disciplined that we can be a tulku for a longer time. And there are some cases, for instance, I was told once that a lady was in a situation of danger, and she had to save somebody in a burning house. And at that time, she saw very clearly what she had to do. She was not nervous. She was not afraid. She didn't know any fear. She knew what she had to do, and she went into that house, took out the child who was there, saved it, and then when she was out of the house, then she became nervous, and then, what did I do? I didn't know what happened, but I knew to, well, a kind of force, a kind of spiritual force entered in her, I think, because she was impersonal at that moment, and at that, maybe just a few minutes, she was a tulku, she was a vehicle of a higher force. And, well, it's all a question of discipline. Discipline your personality, live in your higher self, and you can be anything you want.
Okay, thanks. There was a third question about tulku, but I think you just answered that one as well. Yeah.
Okay. Well, I think I was privileged to to be allowed to give this talk, one I think it's the most, one of the most beautiful doctrines of theosophy, compassion, and we need it very, very much nowadays. And you know, it's very practical. If you look at the situation at the world, if you look, for instance, at the refugees camps in the Greek islands, if you know that so many countries who are not as rich as the European countries are suffering because of the crisis, then if we work from compassion as an individual, but also as a country, then we can make a great step forwards in our evolution. And maybe I can tell that we are working on a new Lucifer who is all about this crisis in the world and the solutions you can invent for the crisis if you work out of compassion. Just a few weeks, I think, and then it will be in English as well. All right, we end. Oh no, just one thing. The next talk, Between Death and Birth, May 17. Without public, of course, but online. You are very welcome to attend that lecture as well. And then we would like to end with an invocation. And in that invocation, they speak about a sun, a golden sun. And you have to realize that that golden sun is you, is your higher self. So not the sun outside you, but the inner force, the inner divinity, the higher self. O thou golden sun of most excellent splendor, illumine our hearts and fill our minds so that we, recognizing our oneness with the divinity, which is the heart of the universe, may see the pathway before our feet and tread it to those distant call of perfection, stimulated by thine own radiant light.